Hi everyone and welcome to the Aircraft Certification Channel. I'm Clarissa Fedel.
I'm Rafaela Caillaux.
In today's video, Rafaela will interview a guest about the development and certification of aircraft air conditioning system.
Yeah, very special guest. But before we start, if you're interested in aircraft certification and development, please subscribe to our channel and click the notifications button to receive a warning every time we upload a new video in the channel. So thanks, Fabio, for being here with us. Could you start introducing yourself to the audience?
Yes. Well, I am a mechanical engineer. I have 18 years experience of developing and certifying environment control systems, especially working for air conditioning, pneumatic system, and inert gas system.
So could you tell us about how the air conditioning system in an aircraft is developed?
Well, developing the air conditioning system of the aircraft is not so different as developing the air conditioning system of a building. Basically, the process is the same. You determine the heat load and then you specify the air conditioning machine to comply with that heat load. That's it.
So what are the parameters that you have to take into consideration to calculate the heat load?
Well, the heat load is basically composed of all the sources of heat in the internal environment of the aircraft. So what are the sources of heat? Well, basically, the people, the electronic equipment, and the heat is that's transferred through the fuselage. For example, the sun radiation, and the convection over the fuselage caused by or a hot environment in case of ground or a cold environment in case of flight.
Okay, and you mentioned that it's very similar to a building air conditioning. So what would be the main difference?
Well, the main difference is that we are talking about aircraft. So building are made of brick. So it's heavy.
Okay.
You don't have weight limitations. In case of the aircraft, you need to optimize the weight of the insulation that you put inside the aircraft. Otherwise, you increase the expenditures of fuel.
Okay. And what about the performance requirements for the air conditioning system?
Well, in fact, we have two performance requirements for the air conditioning system: the pull-up time and pull-down time.
Could you explain a little bit more what those times mean?
Oh, yes. The pull down time is the time requirement for the air conditioning machine to reduce the temperature of the internal environment of the aircraft. Let's suppose that the aircraft is in a hot environment. In Middle East, for example, on summer, you have a hot temperature outside and the aircraft is with the airframe for many hours in that condition.
Mm-hmm.
When you go inside the aircraft and turn on the air conditioning equipment, so the pull down time is the time requirement to reach the set point inside the cabin.
To cool down,
exactly.
Cabin.
And the pull up time is the time requirement to, in the opposite condition. When you are in a cold environment, and you turn on the air conditioning system and the air conditioning need to increase the temperature of the cabin.
Okay.
So this is more a market requirement, it's not a certification requirement. And of course, as the lower this time, better.
Okay, so the faster it gets to the set point, the better.
The better.
So since it's not a certification requirement, because I believe it's more related to passenger comfort and the turnaround time that the aircraft will need to board the passengers and so on, what would be the requirements related to certification regarding the air conditioning system?
Well, we have a very few. Okay. Well, for example, we have the fresh air flow. And no hazardous amounts of contaminants inside cabin in case of failure. For example, CO, CO2 or smoke.
Okay. And so regarding fresh air flow, what are the means of compliance for this requirement?
Well, in case of fresh air flow, the means of compliance is for compliance is the flight test.
Okay.
So we measure the flow that goes inside the cabin in case of normal condition, normal flight, and in case of failure.
Okay, so you mentioned you have to flight test a failure condition. So my question is, would this failure represent a higher risk for the flight test and for the people who is flying this condition?
Before the flight test, in the development phase of the aircraft, there are performed some simulations to determine if the fresh air flow is enough for the occupants during the flight test. And additionally, the flight test team used to mitigate the risk during the flight test. In case of any issue during the flight test, they will have an alternative way of supplying oxygen for the occupants.
Okay, so that's how you mitigate the risk.
Yes, exactly.
So now, what about the total loss of fresh air flow? How you deal with it?
The compliance for total loss of fresh air flow is demonstrated by analysis normally. Okay. The majority of times is by analysis.
Okay, and so you also mentioned there is a smoke requirement. So how do you demonstrate that there are no hazardous quantities of smoke in the cabin? What are those hazardous quantities? What's considered hazardous?
Yes, as you always mention it, it is not a prescriptive requirement. So it's difficult to demonstrate that there won't have any hazardous amounts of smoke inside cabin. So what we do is just showing that no smoke will ingress inside the cabin. We do that by doing proper flight test and demonstrating that the smoke will not ingress in the cabin.
Okay, so you try to avoid the discussions of what amount of smoke would be considered safe. So you just show that there's no smoke penetrating the cabin.
Yes, exactly. There is an alternative way of showing compliance. You can measure the contaminants in a test, it's a specific test, and then you show to the authority that the concentration of contaminants is not high enough to cause hazard for the occupants.
Okay, so that would be another path to show compliance.
Yes.
Much has been discussed about the COVID-19 spread inside the cabin. What are the options available for the aircraft that could deal with this issue? Okay.
This is a good question. The operators now are likely to adopt physical barriers inside the cabin, but this is not a good solution because, as you know, it can impact the cabin safety evacuation requirement.
Okay, so in case of an emergency, it would prevent people from evacuating the aircraft so fast.
Yes, it can increase the time for evacuation, and maybe it will not comply with the minimum time required by the requirement.
Okay, so that's the downside of this solution.
Yes.
And regarding the air conditioning system itself, what would be the impact of those physical barriers inside the aircraft?
Well, these physical barriers can increase the stratification of temperature inside cabin. So some place is going to become hotter and some place is going to become colder.
Okay.
This will increase the flight attendant workload.
Yeah, workload. Lots of people complaining about hot spots and cold spots inside the aircraft.
Yes.
Okay, so it's not much of a certification requirement, but it would more be of a marketing requirement.
Yes, the temperature is not a certification requirement. The temperature set point of the aircraft and the stratification is more of an industry standard.
Mm-hmm.
And not a certification requirement. It's sold as a design characteristics of the aircraft.
Good cabin environment.
Yes.
What would be a good solution to deal with the COVID-19 or other viruses inside the aircraft?
A good solution that would mitigate the risk for contamination with COVID would be a combination between HEPA filter and face masks and adequate ventilation inside cabin.
So those operational measures that are already being taken by the operators.
Yes.
But what is exactly the HEPA filter, how it works?
Well, HEPA filter is a high efficient filter that is capable of filtering 99.97% of particles.
Okay.
So, you know, the COVID normally is attached to a particle, a droplet or a dust or something like. Mm-hmm. And this particle is filtered by a very thinner screen of the HEPA filter.
Okay, so this means that the technical solution is already available, right?
Well, since the beginning of 2000, after the SARS issue and the MERS issue, aircraft are using HEPA filter and the recirculation system. So this filter is capable of catch all these particles and avoid the contamination of the passengers.
But I believe this is still not mandatory, right?
Of course, yes.
It's more of an optional item?
Yes, HEPA filter is an option item, but most operators are using it by now.
Okay, so do you see in the coming future a revision on the regulation to make it not an optional item, but a mandatory item?
It's a difficult question because the filter is not 100% efficient, but the utilization of the HEPA filter with other measures also, for example, the face masks or a good ventilation of sterilization of the aircraft can mitigate the risk of contamination.
Okay. All right. So we'll see what will be coming next from the civil aviation authorities on this matter. So Fabio, I'd like to thank you for your time. Thanks for coming here and sharing with us all your knowledge about the aircraft air conditioning system. And if you want to contact Fabio directly, I'll leave here in the comments his contact. So thanks.
Thank you very much.
Yes, this COVID-19 is really causing trouble in aviation, right? So let us know, how do you feel about flying during this pandemic? And if you like this video, press the like button and subscribe to our channel. Also, you can provide us feedback and suggestions for next videos. Thanks for watching us and see you in the next video.